I'm Jonathan Brent, Executive Director of the YIVO Institute, and it is my bittersweet task to welcome all of you here this evening to commemorate Benjamin Harshav. Before we do that, I think it's appropriate to take a moment or two in silence to think about what happened in Paris. And I would like to begin the evening with a moment of silence with regard to that. Benjamin Harshav was, for me, a great friend. He was a great scholar. He was an author of mine when I was at Yale University Press. He was, in some sense, while I was at YIVO and while I've been here, while I was at Yale and while I've been here at YIVO, something of a dibbuk. He was a dibbuk of the other world for me. He was the first person I called when I was approached about leaving Yale and coming to the YIVO Institute. He was a dibbuk for me in whispering constantly to me about the value of the great culture that the Jews of Eastern Europe and Russia had created. And when he began his work as a dibbuk back in the early 90s, I didn't really know what he was talking about. I had some inklings of this because of the work that my wife and I had done in Eastern Europe and in publishing the work of Czech and Polish and Hungarian writers and artists in our magazine Formations. But the Moscow Yiddish Theater, I hate to admit, was not something I knew much about. Chagall, I knew as, yes, of course, a Jewish artist, but really a Parisian Jewish artist, one whose works were on the walls of most upper middle class Jewish families in the United States, which decorated the walls, I would say. Benjamin made me understand it was much more than decoration. Benjamin made me understand the profound linkage between the world of Marc Chagall and the world of the Russian avant-garde. Well, the Russian avant-garde to me was the world of people like Yuri Alyosha and Mayakovsky and Isaac Babel and one or two others. It took a long time for me to understand that it also included Anski, that it included Chagall and Lisitsky. And I'm saying this because of my profound ignorance at that time, despite years of connection to that world. And I think I speak for the majority of American Jews, even those of Eastern European or Russian extraction, in saying that most know absolutely nothing about where they came from, about what that world constructed, what it offered, what was unique about it. And so for me, Benjamin was, and he still is, one of the great exponents of that world that made it possible for me and through me and the opening up of frontiers here at YIVO, as well as the opening up of frontiers at Yale University Press, to help people understand that that world was not just a footnote to Western history. That world had an authentic place in itself. To put this in a little bit of perspective, you know, I grew up revering people like Lionel Trilling and Peter Gay. And I'll never forget in Lionel Trilling's introduction to the works of Isaac Bobble that he very approvingly quotes Maurice Samuels as saying, well, the Jews of Eastern Europe, they didn't have any words for vegetables. They didn't, for them, birds were birds, but not particular species of birds. They had a limited experience with the world. That's what I read. If Lionel Trilling said it, it had to be true. And only at this relatively advanced stage of my life and career do I understand it to be completely false. And it's people like Benjamin who help to reveal that. Peter Gay, in his national book award-winning book, Modernism, that was published in 2007, wrote that the Jews indeed played a role in the avant-garde. But it was the role of salon keepers, of agents, of journalists, that is to say, of connoisseurs, collectors, not the world of creators. But Benjamin Harshav demonstrates, and others with him, but he was one of the great forces of this, that they were creators, that they had an authentic voice, that not only did they create, but they prophesied. Not only did they prophesy, but they made something that was instrumental in advancing our understanding of the modern world. He used to tell me all the time about Gronovsky, the original founder of the Moscow Yiddish Theater. And in his book on the subject, he quotes from Michoels's memoirs, and Michoels quotes Gronovsky. And Benjamin loved to repeat this to me, that Gronovsky's mantra to the Moscow Yiddish theater was, it is not enough to put a Jew on the stage. It is our task to put a human being on the Jewish stage. And that, it seems to me, is what Benjamin always wanted to do, to find the human being in the most universal way without losing the particularism of the Jewish experience. And this is a fantastic accomplishment from a scholarly, from a moral, from a psychological point of view. I knew him as someone who was full of wit, full of sagacity, who was open-hearted, who was generous to a fault, who had immense erudition, and every time I got done with the conversation with him, there was a quality of cheerfulness in the air. It was only later that I discovered another quality of Benjamin, which was his stubbornness. A stubbornness that it was very difficult to get past. And I'll never forget when he was editing, in fact, not editing, but really creating what became the diary of Hermann Kruk, the Jerusalem of Lithuania that Yale University Press published. We had an interesting situation. Our managing editor came to me one day and she said, on page X, there is a character whose name is Sarah, and on page Y, there is someone whose name is Sarah. And on page Z, there is another variant of the name. She said, it seems as though it's the same character, but I don't know. What do you think? I said, well, call Professor Harshav up, and he'll quickly tell you if it's the same character or not. And she did, and he said, of course it's the same character. What's the matter with you? Here on this street corner, she thought of herself in a Yiddish way. Here on this street corner, in a Polish way. Here in this street corner, in a Hebrew way. Yes, that was the life of the Jews. On a different street corner, you had a different self-conception of yourself. And he was intent on preserving this in the published text. And we had an unbelievable battle with him over this because he wouldn't budge. And eventually it was resolved through a series of footnotes and explanations in the introduction and so forth. But this was an example, and it was an example to me not only of what he treasured, which was the complexity, not only the polyglot nature of Jewish life, but the polyphony of Jewish life, its multicultural contexts, its variety and the displacements of identity that all existed within a single individual. And I cherish this as his friend and as a scholar and as someone who wanted to publish this book, but as his editor, it was impossible. But we got through it. We got through it, and it remains one of the great works of history, certainly of the Jewish experience of Vilna. Benjamin told me a wonderful story, which was he started out life as a collector. And I think that's a really important thing to understand about him. He collected everything. He collected people. He was an avid collector of people. I saw him do it endlessly, especially young people whom he adored, helping them along the way with their careers. He collected editors. He collected friends. He collected words. And his first job, as he said to me, working for Max Weinreich in Vilna as a young boy, was to go into the marketplace and collect obscenities, because Max Weinreich needed these obscenities to fill out his work on the Yiddish language. And so he would go and he would try to extract these from the ladies selling their goods in the marketplace. And in one instance, he said he wasn't really getting anywhere with this one apple seller. She would shoo him away in one way or another until finally he took extreme measures and he stole an apple and ran off with it. And she stood there and she looked and she pointed his finger at him and she said, "May your intestines turn into a telephone wire." And this was the obscenity that he brought, the curse that he brought back to Max Weinreich. Why a telephone wire, nobody knows, but in her mind, that was the worst thing that could happen to your guts. So he collected these things. He collected memory, and he never let go of it. My wife and I met Benjamin and Bobby after a film by chance in New Haven, and we were hungry. So we said, "Well, we're going to the restaurant. Would you like to have dinner with us?" And Benjamin had a big tub of popcorn with him. And he said, "Great." And Bobby said, "Great." And so we went across the street to a restaurant, and he brought his tub of popcorn with him. And we sat down, and he put his popcorn on the table. And he ordered some, I don't even know what it was, but it was some sort of meat. And my wife, who cared about his well-being quite a bit, she said, "Benjamin, please, aren't you at least going to have a salad, something green to go along with this?" He said, "You know, in the world where I came from, there were no vegetables." And it was with tremendous pain that I would pick up the receiver and I would hear his voice in our last conversations, his voice that was always a little kvetchy, a little nudgy, a little intimate, a little knowing, but in the end, a little bit drifting into that other world where he is now and where our thoughts reach him. So that's my experience of Benjamin, a great friend who whom I miss dearly. He never finished the popcorn. I assume that popcorn went with him into the other world. Yeah. So tonight, we have a wonderful group of people who will share their memories about Benjamin, including Barbara Harshav, Bobby, whom everyone knows, Hanan Hever, Jacob and Hilda Blaustein, professor of Hebrew language and literature at Yale University, and unfortunately, Michael Holquist, who was going to be here, who was a dear friend because of his illness, which is quite grave, informed us yesterday that he was not going to be able to come, and I know it breaks his heart, and it's a very sad thing. Bella Meyer, the granddaughter of Marc Chagall, has written comments that Bobby will read. If you had them, you don't have them. I see. Well, maybe they'll turn up. We'll see. Joshua Price is a graduate student in Yiddish studies at Columbia, and Roman Utkin, assistant professor in Russian studies at Davidson College. And there will be a poetry reading by Barbara. But we are going to begin the program this evening with an excerpt from a film by Mira Yedvabnik Van Doren, who is with us here this evening. In 2002, she interviewed Benjamin Harshav and captured it on film. So.
You said that your family was your own family was a place of warfare and language.
Yeah, right. My mother was a principal of Yiddish school, and my mother was left-oriented. She never was a communist member of the party. She suffered terribly during the Soviet purges. Suffered mentally because we were not in the Soviet Union, but she couldn't stand the Stalinist bent that communism took, but nevertheless she was mentally a communist, you see, and therefore Yiddish is the language of the masses, not the clerical language Hebrew. And my father, though he taught both in Polish Jewish schools and in Hebrew Jewish schools, but and in the Hebrew teacher seminar, but and he loved Yiddish and he loved Sholem Aleichem took pride in speaking Yiddish and reading Yiddish literature. But nevertheless, he supported Hebrew education rather than Yiddish education. And I remember a terrible dilemma on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, that my mother, in principle, insisted that school is conducted on Yom Kippur. We are not religious and we don't believe in God's atonement. But my father couldn't bear it. Yom Kippur is a day that you don't go to school. And I was in a real conflict, and I slept late, and I went at 11 o'clock to school. I was half-half, right? But I was torn between those. That was called the war of languages between Yiddish and Hebrew, and the war of languages against Jews who studied in so-called Shabbosówka, that is, Polish schools that did not work on Sabbath, that is, for Jews. And we were persecuted by non-Jewish boys who would run after us with dogs. There was terrible anti-Semitism at the end of the 30s in Vilna. But we persecuted other Jewish children who studied Polish or tried to speak Polish, you see.
Now, which schools did you go to? You went to your mother's
school? I went to my mother's school, which was a terrible problem, of course. And I went then, when I finished that school, I went to Real Gymnasia, that was real Yiddish gymnasium. I mean, there was the religious at the gymnasium. When the Soviets came, four gymnasia were created in Yiddish, in the place of the Polish Jewish schools and the Hebrew Jewish schools and the Real Gymnasium that was Yiddish to begin with. And in two of them, my mother and father were the pedagogical directors. That is, the director of the school was a Communist Party member, was not a teacher. And so that means they had a certain prestige in Vilna, only during that Soviet period. Also after terrible fear, because my father was afraid that somebody will denounce him that he was a Zionist. And he was once a labor Zionist. But my mother went to Mira Bernstein, who was a communist and was the director of the Real Gymnasium, and through her pulled strings and gave my father work. That is, the danger was that if he cannot get work, he has to be sent to Siberia, because that is a parasite. So he did got work, and not only that, he was the director of the pedagogical director.
Well, since we're so close to the German occupation, the German takeover, maybe we should tell the train story and get it out of the way.
No, but it's not interesting. You are talking about Vilna.
Don't tell the whole thing. I don't want to know about Minsk and all the rest of it. Just that one moment of getting off the train and getting back on. That's all.
Okay. As it's known in the literature, one long train of about 3,000 people moved from Kovno through Vilna to Minsk, and that is east. And the Germans came the next day. They were in Vilna on the 24th. There was an interregnum one day, never mind. And we lived not far from the train station. And the landlord of our house said, "Where are you going? Die Deutschen seien ein kulturelle Volk. They will nicht zeppen in die Stadt von Vilna gehen." That is, the Germans are a cultural people. They will not touch the city of the Vilna Gaon, you see. That is, we are safe. But my father answered, "I read Mein Kampf and I believe him." And since my father was in exile in World War I in Siberia, and my mother too, all we took was knapsacks with sweaters and cans of preserved food. And we went to the train and we squeezed in. There was terrible scenes. A young man came into the train, and we were squeezed. And he wanted to bring his mother up. His mother was still downstairs. And there was no way. So they said, "Take your bag." He had a long sack with clothes or whatever he had. So he did that. He threw out that sack out the window and pulled his mother through the window and put her on the upper shelf in the car. And so we went to the old... We were presumably Soviet citizens, but we didn't have Soviet passports yet. And we went to the old Polish-Soviet border. And they said, "All Zapadniki get off the train." That is, all Westerners get off the train. Those who were not Soviet citizens before 1939. Everybody went off on the left side of the train, where there was a kind of platform. And for some reason, we were close to the door, but for some reason, we had two small children. That is, I was 13, but my sister was 7. And we went off on the right-hand side, and there was an embankment about 2 meters lower. And then a German plane came and strafed the train. And as we know from Krug and from other sources, the people of the Jews of that train couldn't cross the Soviet border and walked back to Vilna. It took them a long time to walk. Most of them, they were slaughtered by peasants or by German army and so on. And we were on the right-hand side, and the train started moving in order to escape the German airplane, which was ridiculous, but that's what the fact. And I was 13, and I said, and my father was in terrible depression at that point, and I said, "We must jump back." The train was moving, and it was quite high from the embankment, right? And somehow we jumped one after another, and I remember trembling, "Can all of us come in?" And there was a young NKVD, that is a Russian Secret Service soldier, who was watching that door, And he let us in. He was 18 years old and he let us in. And so we came to Soviet Union. I don't know of any other case of that train who survived that way.
Let's take a quick break.
Thank you very much, Mira. Now I think we will begin hearing from those who are going to share their memories. And the first person we will hear from is Ehud Hrushovski. Oh, do you want to speak, Barbara? Oh, okay, very good. Very good. Yeah, okay, excellent. Yeah. Well, of course I want to introduce you. It seemed to me that... Bobby, you hardly need an introduction. I think you're known to everyone. Bobby Harshav is an eminent translator, scholar, a friend of the YIVO Institute, and a teacher, and a real force in the world of Yiddish literature.
First of all, thank you all for coming. It's heartening to see. The issue here was, can you hear me? Okay. To find writings of Benjamin where he talks about his personal life, and to my great amazement when I started looking, there aren't any. Except for the introduction to the Crook diaries, where he does talk about his growing up in Vilna. But let me just sort of make a couple of footnotes about Jonathan's comments. First of all, that popcorn never ran out. We had no idea. He sat there and all this for hours, it seems, he was eating the popcorn. It was a surreal evening. The place was surreal. And the other thing was that ich machen von dein Kischkes a telephone. About 3 years ago, we had a visit from Benjamin's daughter and her, I guess, Nitzan was 7 or 8 at the time, and he's a great mimic. And Benjamin taught him that line, and he managed to get it perfectly with the accent and everything. So it lives on. So this is what he wrote about the issue in Vilna. By the way, I don't think he talks about it here, but there was the issue of, he was 13 at the time, and the train, whenever the train stopped at a station, there was a boiling water, a place where you could get boiling water. And he was the one assigned to do that because he was nimble and young. And so once, when he was getting the boiling water, the train just moved off. There were no schedules. And it just went away. This is days before cell phones. And being an enterprising and intelligent 13-year-old, he just kept hopping on trains going east. Now, I think this led to a lifelong tendency to do that. We would get on the train to New York, and Benjamin would just jump off the train. Where are you going? I'll be right back. And at the very last minute, he would come back. And I said to him when he told me this thing about the hot water, and it took him 3 weeks to catch up with his parents. And I said, they must have been, you know, beside themselves with worry. He said, well, it was a great adventure for me. Okay. That was Benjamin. So this is what he wrote about Vilna. Did I do that? I was born in Vilna, Jerusalem of Lithuania, as we proudly call it. My parents were Jewish secular intellectuals. My mother, Dvorah Freidkis, was a mathematics teacher and principal of a Yiddish secular school, the Sofia Markovna Gurevich Gymnasium. And my father, Dr. Abraham Hrushovski, later Agassi, taught history in Hebrew schools, the Hebrew Teacher Seminar, and the Polish-Jewish Gymnasium of Dr. Epstein. In 1940-41, under Soviet rule, they were both pedagogic directors. We've got that from the that wonderful clip. At dawn of June 22, 1941, Soviet Vilna was bombarded by German airplanes, even before war was declared. After a day and night of bombardments on the 23rd, my parents, my little sister, and I left our apartment with small rucksacks and hit the road. The neighbors were amazed. You're leaving everything just like that? The Germans are cultured people. They will not touch the city of the Vilna Gaon. That was how people responded after Kristallnacht, the humiliation of Jews in Vienna and in Poland, and the establishment of crowded ghettos in Łódź and Warsaw. Although those things were unpleasant, no one suspected the final solution. But my historian father said, I read Hitler's Mein Kampf, and I believe him. I'm going to skip the rest of this paragraph because he told that in the film. When I read Crook's diary, I feel that I could have been on every page of it. I was 13 when the war broke out. What would I have done when my whole street was taken to Ponar, as it was? And I knew so many of the names in this book. My best childhood friend, Gabi Keller, worked in Crook's library. After his father, the historian Dr. Moishe Heller, died in the ghetto. Our mutual friend and classmate, Itzik Rudoshevsky, wrote a memorable ghetto diary. Both perished. Boys a few years older went to the partisans of Vremel Zeleznikov, the Lubotsky brothers. Their leader, Abakovner, was a friend of my father's, and we spent the summer before the war near the summer camp of HaShomeret Zair. When Crook mentions names of people who died in the Estonian camps, I see them before my eyes. My mother's students, Jozik Schreiber, and his father, the director of the Yiddish Technikum, the tall, thin Grisha Tsapelovich, commander of the 2nd Battalion of FPO, who perished in Estonia. And so many students, friends, and colleagues of my parents appear here in their last journey. The doctor and cultural activist, Pomerantz, the teacher and principal of Real Gymnasia, Mira Bernstein, who organized a Yiddish school in the ghetto. The modest and splendid scholar, Zelig Kamenovich, our neighbor in the house owned by the publisher B. Kletzkin, the music teacher Gerstein, who directed a famous choir, and many others. The medieval narrow streets of the ghetto were so familiar. I walked there every day on the way to Real Gymnasium on Rudnitska Street. And the pastoral wooded hills of Ponar, which became the slaughterhouse of 100,000 Jews, were a frequent place of my family's Saturday outings. There's a special place in my heart for the YIVO. Its founder, Dr. Max Weinreich, and his family were friends of our family. When I was 1 year old, I got a printed invitation to their home for the foundation of Young Vilna. Weinreich always understood that without a young generation, Yiddish culture was doomed. He later used the same title for the budding group of modern Yiddish poets. On the 10th anniversary of the YIVO in 1935, the historian Simon Dubnov and the artist Marc Chagall came to the conference from Riga in Paris and visited the children's summer colony where my father was director. And at the age of 12, I had the honor of serving as a guide at the YIVO exhibition on the 25th anniversary of Y.L. Peretz's death. It was a small, poor wooden house on Vivulski Street 18, just a few blocks from my home. But it exalted the pure principles of humanistic science. In its poverty, it was a great research institution. This is really the only time he wrote anything about his, that I know, that he wrote about his own life. Everything else was scholarly, but with a scholarship that was so broad that everything included everything, and is as broad as the sea without borders, without banks. Just one more. He concluded his preface to the Crook diary with, "Jews have always remembered the first Jerusalem as the utopian home of their destiny, dignity as a nation. The recent Khorban, as the survivors called it, the destruction of European Jewry, is of the same magnitude as the two destructions of the temple and the state in the ancient land of Israel. Now that a worldly third Jerusalem has been built in its original place, we must not forget the second Jerusalem, that is Vilna, in Jewish history." And then finally, his book on Yiddish, which I recommend to all of you who haven't read it yet, The Meaning of Yiddish. Benjamin's scholarly writing was always so lucid, which indicated a generosity of spirit to make something understandable to and available to everybody who could read and think. That book, he wrote, is dedicated to the memory of my mother, mathematics teacher and early feminist, principal of an experimental Yiddish secular school in pre-war Vilna, who saw in elitist Yiddish culture the dignity of her people and the pride of her personal revolution. She was the Yiddish pillar of my bilingual childhood on a vanished planet. She died in peace in Haifa at the age of 90, speaking Hebrew. Okay.
Our next speaker now is Ehud Hrushovski.
Thanks very much to you and Bobby for the organization of this evening. I'm Benjamin's son, and you can't hear me? No?
It won't be recorded unless it's recorded.
Okay. Is this better? My sisters and our children couldn't come, but will watch and are here in spirit. Also, by the way, Gabi Weinreich, who was the youngest son of Max, and also a close friend of my father's in Vilna, told me that he's here in spirit with us. He couldn't come either. And thanks very much to everyone who came. I know that for some of you, my father's work and life was deeply meaningful, and for some of you, it's incidental. And he loved every single one of these contacts, whether it was a deep contact with common roots over time, or whether it was an incidental intellectual contact from someone from another continent. It was very, very meaningful for him. Everything for him was people. Everything for him was human. I have no expertise of any of his work, and there are many experts in many fields. I only know him as his son. But nevertheless, in the last, somehow when thinking about this evening over the last few days and weeks, I was reflecting about his work, and I would like to still say something about it. It seems to me like from a distance of a few months now, like one great symphony with many strands, apparently very different. At a given time you'd work on something, on different things, all connected to his family. Family was always deep commitment, and all this depth that was in him was there to be given to the people he loved. So I would like to talk about that. I mean, it's in the book that Bobby just mentioned, The Meaning of Yiddish, he talks about the introspectivists, and the later, together with Bobby, they did an epic translation of Blaustein and Yale's and of American Yiddish poets. And just one phrase from the manifesto says, "For us, all is personal." In 1919, Blaustein and Leles and Minkov, and this is, and he explains there that this does not mean, it means exactly the opposite of escapism, of just being concerned with personal feelings. It means exactly, the next phrase in the manifesto says, everything is personal, those wars and revolutions and historical events, and for him it would have been science, and everything becomes personal. And that's the way he lived his life. I mean, he happened to go through deeply meaningful events in the life of the world, of the Jewish people, of the Yiddish culture, and of Hebrew, but it's still not a trivial thing to go through it in with such a deep connection to it, both in understanding things and in doing things. So if I mention his work, I think I'm mentioning his life as well. And some of the strands that some now seem very, very clear are, well, first of all, Yiddish, starting with Yiddish, and in many ways ending with Yiddish. Hebrew, parts, he had a very major role in the creation of Hebrew as an intellectual language, as an academic language, in the direction that Hebrew poetry took. Theory, this was, if you asked him when he was 40, this would have been his calling for him, creating a science of literature, being part of that, creating a group of people in Tel Aviv University who together, this was always for him, together with other people, who together create a theory of literary text. For him, it was very central, and it was the one thing that he talked about throughout his life, that he would write the great theoretical book, which never happened. The book never happened. And he always, I believe from the days that he was doing his PhD with Velik and Yale to the days, he understood a few months, I think, before then that it would never be written. But until then, he was always discussing his great book. To me, it's there, yeah? I mean, it's there through his students in some ways and through some very, very short papers. I'm a mathematician, and we write short things. And he thought it wasn't there in the sense of the humanities. There was no book. But some short article that he later collected on metaphor. A number of articles show a very, very deep theoretical understanding of what human understanding is in text, in literature. And two other strands are history. He wrote some books about history later on. He lived it in a very deep way. He wrote Language in the Time of Revolution about the Hebrew language. And he wrote many things in his later years about the history of the Jews in the 20th century. For him, it was one huge thing, not, you know, the history of Yiddish, of Hebrew, of many, many movements. It was really history in the sense of Marc Bloch. It was history in the sense of all the human sciences combined. And it was the same. I mean, it was literature, it was sociology. All of it was language for him. And I dare say painting also was a secret strand of the history of art that became realized in his later years in his writings in Chagall, of course connected with the Jewish people. But I remember as a child being amazed and not knowing that he had any connection with this, that he asked me to type for him on these stencils. I don't know if you know what they are. You have to be very careful when you type on stencils. If you make one mistake, you have to throw it out. And, typing what became an anthology of manifestos in the arts, yeah. It was always significant throughout his life, and in his last days also, he was looking at the pictures in his house and looking at the way they were changing with his changing cognition and remembering aspects of individual paintings and saying, this now looks different. So I was thinking about these things. One strand that never did materialize was continued by me in some sense. For a year, he studied mathematics and physics. And it was in Shkalov, just after the end of the war, 45-46. And he excelled in it. He did extremely well. It seems clear that he would continue in this direction. He always loved it. And it was, there were many, many different stories about why he changed his direction after the war. He had, in the 3 years that passed until 49, he was in the Dlouhé movement in Europe, passing first back to Poland and then illegally to Germany and eventually in Hapala, and in the last illegal boat going to Israel. And then fighting in the Palmach, in the War of Independence. So obviously many, many things happened. And when he was released from the army, he went to study literature. And he told many stories about why, many different points of view, as if he didn't know, well. One of them Menachem Brinker once told me, he doesn't know why, but I know why. His ambition was to be a Hebrew poet. That's what he wanted to do. That's what he thought would be important for the people at that time. And when I told this to my father, he said, yes, this is true. This is what he wanted. I think I'll skip a lot of things and I'll just quote a few things from him. I want to say that when I was growing up, the Yiddish strand was not at all evident. The theory strand was evident, the Hebrew strand was evident, and it's not a trivial thing. I mean, it was in this symphony, there was a great beginning with his childhood in Vilna, with the triumph of Yiddish culture, then the destruction of it. Still writing poems in Yiddish about the Shoah, writing poems within the Palmach, within the greatest anti-Yiddish environment that one could imagine, where it was shameful to be a Jew from the Gula, writing poems in Yiddish, publishing poems in Yiddish, beginning a Hebrew poetry movement at the same time participating in the Yiddish one. It was a very, very non-trivial thing. But even for him, it was a bit hidden. For most of his life, the Yiddish strand was hidden and came back very much in his work with Bobby in the last 20 years or more. Two very short quotes. One from a poem which is actually about painting. It's about an imaginary paper, Gabi Daniel, but it's illustrated by his deep friend, Moshe Kupferman. For him, it was always through people. And just two lines. Zeinenu shir al adama vedam, zehu shir al osher leshonav shel haadam. This is not a poem about earth and blood. This is a poem about the richness of the languages of mankind. It's very much how he was. He saw many things, many ideologies. He saw the whole stream of ideologies around him in a very, very ideological century. And he was never an extremist. Yes, he saw the deep richness of everything as combined with everything else. Languages, not just language. And another poem that I would like to read, but I don't myself speak Yiddish. And, you know, he loved Yiddish, and he did so much in order to keep it alive, but he was a realist. He didn't think it could be kept alive by sociologically in terms of a community. He thought it could be kept alive in the way he said that, you know, that ancient Greek literature was kept alive intellectually. And he did so much to translate it and to write about it. This was his contribution to it. Anyhow, this is a poem that I'm reading. I'm going to read you a very improper English translation of his own Hebrew translation of the Yiddish original. And it's called The Last Yiddish Poet. It's written somehow in a very humorous kind of tone, but it's very serious. And he says, in the past, they used to say, drag your body another stretch of sand. You're almost late for the race of torches. If you make it, you may become the last Yiddish poet. And then he says, not even that. Now there are even lesser poets. So I'll interpret that a little bit. It's a relay race, and of course it's the relay race of Yiddish poets. I didn't realize until very recently to what extent he was the great hope of Yiddish poetry. Gladstein wrote this, and incidental people tell me this. He wanted to be part of the relay race. He wanted to be also a Yiddish poet, and he thought he might be the last one. But Race of Torches also talks about, you know, to hand the torch to the next person. But it's also real tortures. It's also the war, and it's in the last battle, the very last battle of the War of Independence. It was a defeat for the Israeli side. And there was a torch of a burning mutzav, what do you call it, a burning position, and running away in the sand for 3 kilometers, not knowing if you will make it. It's also there. At the end, the poem goes on. At the very end, it says, stuck between the double doors of understanding, your first language. And this is how it was always. It was about understanding and about his first language. Okay, I think I'll just stop here. Thank you.
Uh,
Our next speaker is Hanan Hever, Jacob and Hilda Blaustein, professor of Hebrew at Yale University.
Benjamin Harshav. Benjamin Harshav Hrushovski invented the Israeli literature. Harshav was the leader of Likrat, the 1950s group of poets who offered post-symbolist modernism as an alternative to the national symbolist pathos which dominated Hebrew poetry until then. Natan Zach, Yehuda Amichai, Moshe Dor, Arye Sivan, Moshe Ben Shaul, and other poets who came to Jerusalem in the wake of the 1948 war to study at the Hebrew University, gathered around Benjamin Hrushovski, spending many hours, often staying till dawn, at his rooftop apartment on the fifth floor next to the first building of the Knesset, where they learned from him the modernist tradition. Hrushovski, upon his arrival to Palestine, Eretz Israel, as an illegal immigrant, volunteered to the Palmach and participated in battles fought by the Arel Brigade. He studied the early 1950s at the cradle of the Hebrew literature. By then, Hrushovski was already a published poet. Yiddish modernist poetry book, Stäuben, Dust, was published in Munich in 1948. During his 2 years in Germany, after World War II, he read, or in his word, devoured pages and pages of modernist poetry in Yiddish, German, Russian, French, and English. Now in Israel, he studied the history of Hebrew poetry, but also searched for an alternative to the pathos of the Hebrew poetry of the time, written by Avraham Shlonsky, Matan Alterman, and their followers. The notion that was the driving force in Hrushovski and his friends' search was to find normal, universal literature, a literature of a nation like any other nation. But in fact, this aspiration was another name to the need of repress the trauma of the 1948 war from the surface of the literary discourse. Yehuda Amichai, for whose poetry Harshav felt strong affinity, wrote upon returning from the war his famous poem, Rain on the Battlefield, which he dedicated to the memory of Dickie, his friend who fell in the war. And now I'll read here of the fine translation by Benjamin and Barbara Harshav, and I quote, "Rain falls on the faces of my friends, my living friends who cover their heads with a blanket, and my dead friends who don't." The restrained representation of war in the poem is a representation that represses the trauma of the 1948 war. And in this poem, it is quite visible because the sharp differentiation between the dead soldiers and the living ones is reduced to the mere materiality of a simple blanket, which is no use anymore when covering the body of the dead soldiers against the rain. Amichai wrote this poem in an ironic defiance of the pathos of the mythical metaphor of the living dead, which dominated Alterman's poetry and the poetry of the Palmach generation. This metaphor, which merges the dead with the living, presents the story of the fallen as an optimistic story of salvation and the fascination with the life that will continue to exist in the eternal national collective memory. Recruits the pain of the private death in the war to the national cause. The same bitter irony appears also in another Amichai poem of the same time. God takes pity on the kindergarten children, which is a poem about the cruelty of war, written at its wake, offering ironically the improbable ability of bliss and lover's happiness to protect the fighters now in the other days. The metaphor of the kindergarten attempts helplessly to protect the grown-ups who will, and I quote, have to crawl on all fours in the blazing sand to get to the first aid station, dripping blood. End of quote. The manifest at the head of the first copy of Likrat, published in 1952, explicitly states that although Likrat purposes are not clearly articulated, and I quote, not presenting the purpose does not mean evading discussion, nor ignoring in principle the problems facing a writer at large and the Israeli writer specifically, such as the relations between art and society, the relation between the writer and the general public, etc. End of quote. But from the rest of the manifest, it is clear that the timing of founding Likrat immediately after the war was critical, and that in one way or another, the characteristics of Israeli literature founded by the group members under the leadership of Benjamin Hrushovski was from them a literary reaction to the war that brought about the foundation of the state. And I quote, "It seems to us that our is the first attempt to unite a group of writers whose first artistic fruits came to fruition after the War of Independence, that is, at the end of the 1940s. Today's reality is not the exciting reality of the war years, which gave rise to a group of poets and authors of a variety of different colors and shades. Our reality is a gray and faded and sullen face. And it is against this background that the quality of the work of art will be judged. And the judgment is indeed extremely brave." End of quote. The members of Likrat then offered the young Israeli culture a new persona of an Israeli poet, which they form as a post-traumatic reaction to the war. But contrary to the celebratory character of the literature of the Palbach generation, at the center of Likrat proposed Israeli poetics stood the figure of irony, the most effective literary device for keeping a safe distance from the trauma and the pain of those who were mentally hurting as a result of the war. Placing Likrat's literature as a reaction to the traumas on the base of which the state of Israel has been founded can also explain the title, Likrat, towards, as a forward-looking gaze into the future, a gaze that leaves behind the past riddled with the hardship of the Jews in the 20th century. This included, of course, the 48 war. Choosing the title Likrat is not only a conscious choice of a forward-facing gaze, which focuses on Israel's contemporary way of life, but is also a choice of an ironic gaze, which represses the Jews' past of the traumas of the Shoah and the war. It's maybe better to me to say Churban. The speaker in the poems is specific and ironic, and as they phrase it in the manifest, and I quote, that innocence, that youthful face, that it is possible to conquer the world with our own powers, has long passed from the heart. It has been replaced by skepticism, cynicism, and bad bewilderment. We shall be aware then, from expulsive declarations and from promises and obligations which might end in bitter disappointment. Likrat shows Israeli present and future while negating and repressing the Jewish fate belonging to the past. This is forgetfulness, which often is in an act of banishment from the memory, or even repression. Even when the Jewish past is mentioned, it is overpowered by the politics of rejecting Jewish Ashkenazi particularism in favor of a new Israeli identity which puts on a universal appearance. But so far, this is only one half of the story. Surprisingly, and in stark contrast to the meaning of the title Likrat, implying a forward gaze into Israeli future, leaving the Jewish past behind, Benjamin Hrushovski was also active in the opposite pole. In fact, he was active in two parallel and even I can say, contradictory planes, and at one and the same time. On the one hand, he was actively inventing Israeli literature, utilizing universalism that repressed through the ironic gaze of the new Hebrew Israeliness, his and his friends' traumas. But on the other hand, and with no less force, he remained loyal to his work as an ethnic Jewish poet and continued writing poems in Yiddish and was even involved in founding of Young Israel, the literary group of Yiddish writers in the state of Israel. And so, in 1951, while protesters threw stones at the Knesset building next to his place, Hrushovski, under the name of Hey Benjamin, or Hey Benjamin, was writing in Yiddish the expressionist poema, Die Henschke von Gewattkeit, Bravery Glove. And in 1948, he wrote in Yiddish his poem, Von Militärischem Tagebuch, from the military diary. Later on, he became a major translator of modernist Yiddish poetry into Hebrew and English. Undoubtedly, this is an unusual intensive activity in Israel of the early 1950s. It also precedes the opposite trajectory of ethnization that became prominent in the canon of Israeli literature only many, many years later. It seems that only an intellectual, an artist of the stature of Benjamin Harshav Hrushovski could have carried in his great intellectual personality these two contradictory opposites.
Now, Bobby, will you come back to read Bella?
I'm going to take this opportunity to put a little parenthesis on and make a couple of remarks. A few months ago, a good friend of ours called and said that he wanted to talk to me about Benjamin, and I said, sure. And he came over and he said, you know, one of the great things about Benjamin is that he was so modest. And I thought about that. I said, yeah, he was, because he knew so much that he knew what he didn't know, and was really quite as really intelligent people are modest. He was modest, and at the ceremony we had at Yale, it was kind of funny because Peter Brooks talked about how one day at the Whitney Humanities Center there, off the cuff, Benjamin just gave them a half-hour discussion of the first page of the book of Genesis. And I'll tell you why that bothered me, because we have, once a year, we have this post-Passover e-Seder, or non-Seder, or whatever. And he would always say to me, don't ask me about the Bible, because I don't know anything about the Bible. And there's Peter talking about him giving them an off-the-cuff half-hour disquisition about Genesis. So, you know, I thought, damn, he really got me on that one. So, and also to comment on what Hanan just said, Benjamin's middle name was Irony. And, you know, it was a wonderful characteristic to live with. It was fun, and it's a good position to take on the world, especially now. These are Bella Chagall's, Bella Myers comments. Unfortunately, she couldn't be here, but this is what she wrote very kindly. When I first became aware of Professor and Barbara Harshav's writings, I was sure they were a miracle, and probably they are. Where did Benjamin Harshav come from? What surface of paint by my grandfather did he hide behind? What made him perceive the innermost mischievous gestures, allusions, and jokes, dreamlike spiritual reverences, and most guttural biblical chants, Yiddish literary and popular references and Russian poetry, all imbued in Marc Chagall's pictorial world. Professor Harshav's gift to art history, to history, and to the world is immense. The sharing of his deep literary and spiritual understanding of the world Marc Chagall grew up in and emerged from has become an invaluable and revolutionary source for a new and much deeper understanding of my grandfather's work. Thank you, with all my heart and admiration. Bella.
Now, Joshua Price will come up and share his thoughts.
I'm honored to be part of such an esteemed group of speakers, and I want to thank those at YIVO for hosting and organizing this remembrance. For me, Benjamin Harshav was first and foremost a teacher. Though even that term carries a certain formality, quite at odds with the weekly sessions we embarked upon for three semesters beginning in the fall of 2009. It was several months earlier in May when we first met in his and Bobby's North Haven home. He had responded to my handwritten letter with an email, starting with a quaint and rightly skeptical line, quote, "How nice you're interested in Yiddish literature," end quote. I and another student soon found ourselves sitting on his couch, stumbling through Moshe Leib Halpern's Memento Mori, wondering if we would pass the test and manage to convince him to take us on in the fall. It is a credit to Professor Harshav's generosity that he, in fact, did take us on. The first semester was an intensive reading of the left side pages, that is, the Yiddish side, of his and Bobby's massive anthology, American Yiddish Poetry, which has served for so many as an inexhaustible resource for discovering and luxuriating in one of the richest and most diverse traditions of Yiddish literature. The other student had graduated by the time we embarked on our second semester, a reading of Ashpigel auf Stein, the anthology of Soviet Yiddish poetry and prose, which Professor Harshav, then Hrushovski, helped prepare under the editorship of Chone Shmerok. And we finished with a semester-long study of Avram Tsutskever, likewise the subject of an anthology of translations by the Harshavs. Professor Harshav was the one to select the material in each of these three cases. I had made a small campaign for the prose of Mendele, but was smart enough to defer to his taste. Poetry was his greatest love, and the material here, American, Soviet, and Tsutskever, encapsulates well the transnational Jewish modernism that animated and underwrote so many of Professor Harshav's academic and belletristic interests and endeavors. Needless to say, his personal connections to each of these bodies of literature, he was a translator and or editor of all three, goes some way towards illustrating his prolific scholarly and critical activity. There is little of Jewish literature that Professor Harshav has not touched in some way. Our sessions were as yet the closest approximation to Torah Lishma I have encountered. A syllabus was drawn up at the beginning, merely to check off administrative boxes. A grade was assigned at the end to check off some more boxes. And the only homework was to prepare texts for the following week. We sat and read and occasionally discussed Rak B'Yiddish. That was it. I say occasionally because the focus was indeed on the act of reading, its sensual pleasures, its rhythms, its immediacy. Professor Harshav was the first to introduce me to the formal elements of poetry, right from the sonnet rings of Laelis to the propulsive dactyls of Halpern to the folk epics of Kulbach. Only an intimate understanding of meter and rhythm, of those inventive rhymes where the Slavic components were paired with Lashon Kodesh, of the deeply elusive resonances of Yiddish itself to Jewish histories near and far, past and present, only equipped with this understanding could we fully inhabit the universe of the poem and appreciate and ultimately critically evaluate its aesthetic achievement. This attention to the formal qualities of poetry was no doubt a product of a certain highbrow Tel Aviv structuralism, but it was theory mobilized for the purpose of interpretation, rigor in the name of aesthetic delight, systematicity in the name of a looser, pluralistic, free-ranging, associative, and thus finally traditionally Jewish exegesis. At least in our readings, he did not have time for theory for theory's sake. It had to be useful. It had to bring us back to the text, back to the world of the poem and the poet, and the world in which the poet wrote and lived in relation to other poets. Poetry was not to be overloaded with critical apparatuses, but rather occasionally enriched by them. Poetry was not meant to be looked through as a window onto history or biography, but perhaps read as an echo thereof, with an autonomous and subversive voice and logic of its own. Poetry was not reducible to patterned arrangements of stresses and syllables, but one had to start reading with an eye to these very arrangements if true interpretation, the goal of all Jewish reading, was possible. Halavai, some of today's literary scholars should take a page from his book. Beyond these hermeneutic lessons that I take with me from our sessions, I also take some sense of the intimate connection between literature and life, and the continuum that existed both for Professor Harshav and for many of the leading lights of Yiddish and Hebrew literature he studied, between criticism, translation, and original belletristic writing. I got a taste of this continuum from my work as Professor Harshav's research assistant, tracking down primary texts to be included in his latest book, 3,000 Years of Hebrew Versification, compiling a list of words for his revived project for a Yiddish OED, and most movingly, gathering and editing his Yiddish poems for inclusion in the forthcoming Kol HaShirim al HaLida. His work, from the scholarly monographs to the translations to the original poems, fed off each other in ways still to be examined, and crossed as many borders as he himself did. Vilna and Yiddish, Tel Aviv and Hebrew, New Haven and English, Benjamin Hrushovski and Benjamin Harshav, and Hey Benjamin and Gabi Daniel. The generic, geographical, and linguistic matrix formed by his life and works is in many ways a microcosm of the Mesoira and Yerusha of Jewish modernism and Jewish modernity. There is no doubt that this Mesoira will live on, thanks to Professor Harshav's monumental work. But if we needed additional proof. Last week, I was reading with one of my students Max Weinreich's Die Geschichte von Bes und Bes, a children's story published in Vilna in 1937. It tells the story of a single-letter Bes who escaped from his book one night and attacked Gabi, Max's son. The other letters decide to excommunicate the Bes, temporarily leaving the entire city of Vilna without a letter. People must eat kartoffel instead of bulbis, zemmel instead of bulkes, and so on. To boot, Gabi's friend is noted as having lost his head. Benya becomes Enya. My hunch is that this is a thinly veiled reference to a then 9-year-old Benjamin Hrushovski himself. Now, the student I was reading with is named Max Weinreich, none other than the great-grandson of the eminent linguist and very author of Die Geschichte von Bes und Bes. More fitting proof of the strength of the golden agate and Benya's place in its most storied links, I cannot imagine. I think it only appropriate to conclude with one of Professor Harshav's poems. I have chosen Shnei in Yerushalayim, first written on the occasion of the arrival of snow to the city in the winter of 1950, and reprinted in Professor Harshav's 1994 collection of Yiddish poetry, Take Af Chikavis. It recently figured in Shachar Pinsker's remembrance of Professor Harshav in Haaretz and the journal In Geveb, from which I take Saul Zaret's translation of the final stanza. Schnee in Yerushalayim. Weist Schnee, gut, was bist gekommen. Ich wollte doch ausgegangen verumit nach dein saftigen idischen Loschen. Meine Schreinem, die nordeldicke Bruschen, haben schon lang zum Himmel gespitzt mit der Teine, die Schneien, die puchige Schneien, wo seinen. Und ort bist du unserer wieder. Hast gewiss a Gruß gebracht von die meschunedick verschneite Brüder. Du, weißer Pferd von ewigen idischen Träumen, was pflegst kommen zu reiten in die verkaufete Hintergässlach von unser Weiten, hinter die Hare Choshech verblieben im Golis, von deiner Masolis und deiner Blaue zu pressen, auf nit der warmte Fenster, hab mir schon bald vergessen. Bis nit kein Schabesgoi gewen in unsere Enge dalet Ames, und euch dein Keten gebrasg in die Euren von jüdische Mames, sennen mir schon lang Meuchel gewen, wie ein eigenem stifferischen Kartovis. Kum, Schnee, trest sich in dein Gräus Gräusen versen, und wäre Jeschuvnik in dem Land von die Ovis. Weißt, Schnee, mir seinen doch beide auf du, als wird die Hitz dir nicht losen zu Ruh in der heiliger Stadt. Is eider mir zu gehen wieder, lommer sich verkleiben salbe zweit in a Sod, wo keiner set uns nit, wo keiner tret uns nit, und ich will dir lehnen meine Lieder. You can tell, Snow, yes, the two of us are already on familiar terms, that the heat won't let you rest in the holy city. So before we melt away, let's escape together to some secret corner where no one will see us, where no one will follow us, and I will read to you my poems. Thank you.
Now it's my pleasure to ask Alexandra Schatzkich to come up. Alexandra is an art historian, a writer, a world authority on the Russian avant-garde. It was Benjamin who introduced me to Alexandra many years ago and enabled us at Yale University Press to publish her great works on Vitebsk and on Malevich.
My words dedicated to my dear friend Benjamin Harshav will wear a more personal, lyrical character. I will not talk about his enormous achievements as scholar, poet, translator, teacher. These are seen in his many books and articles. However, I will inevitably touch on the great contribution made by Benjamin in his numerous writings about the art of Marc Chagall. I met Benjamin and his wife Barbara in Moscow, and it seems to me it was in the last month of the existence of the Soviet Union. Benjamin got my telephone number from the organizers of the exhibition Marc Chagall, Russian Years, triumphantly held in Switzerland and in the Janada Foundation and then in the Kunsthalle Cologne. Benjamin called me and arranged a meeting in the restaurant of the National Hotel. There to meet me, a cheerful, energetic gentleman rose from the table. I was surprised that the American guest was fluent in Russian because I did not expect it. The circumstances of his good knowledge of the Russian language were revealed later. Benjamin told me that he had received a commission from the Guggenheim Museum to write article for the upcoming exhibition of works by Marc Chagall. I knew well the literature dedicated to Marc Chagall, but I've never met the name Benjamin Harshav among the art historians and critics who wrote about the artist. Benjamin explained to me that he was not an art historian, he is a poet, scholar, and specialist on Jewish culture, and that's why his approach to the work of Chagall would be different from all the others. Benjamin and Barbara invited me to visit them in the United States, in their house in the neighborhood of New Haven, as Benjamin was a professor at Yale University. I mentioned these well-known facts in detail because for me, at this time, a resident of the Soviet Moscow, it all sounded like a message of life on Mars. Nevertheless, I am a polite person. I did not want to offend the American guests, and that's why I took their address and their telephone number. All this was before the era of the internet, email, and other amenities. But I found myself in the hospitable home of Benjamin and Barbara in 1993 during my first extended stay in the United States. And then for many years, this house for me was one of the main places in America. I was interested in Benjamin's own biography, as it became clear that his real name was Hrushovski, and this name obviously was Polish. But it turned out that Benjamin's family was closely connected with Lithuania, and his native city, Vilna, was a capital of Yiddish culture. After the beginning of World War II and the occupation of the Baltic countries by the Soviet Union, Benjamin's family had fallen to the east of the country, and this history was the usual familiar to me. But I was enormously surprised that Benjamin can escape to the new state of Israel in the late 1940s. This was absolutely unique. In light of the tragic history of the Jews in the 20th century, and especially considering what happened to the outstanding figures of Jewish culture under Stalin, such a turn of destiny was seen by me as a miracle, a great miracle. This sense of wonder never left me during the 20 odd years of familiarity and friendship with Benjamin. Firstly, the house of Benjamin and Barbara had a strong atmosphere of love, and not only of spiritual love. Benjamin and Barbara were just as much in love as teenagers. It has not been demonstrated, but it felt good. It was a big house full of books, a kind of high heat center of the intellectual life and unflagging interest of its owners, their attention to everything going on and responsiveness to it. I am a scholar on Chagall's art, and for me, Benjamin's books and articles are of great importance because the effectiveness of new angles from which he explored the works of the great son of Vitebsk. The art of Marc Chagall arose on the crossroads of many cultures, and Benjamin shows convincingly that the biggest and most decisive influence that shaped the world of the great son of the city Vitebsk was the verbal culture of the Pale of Settlement in Russia, by Jewish proverbs, figures of speech, and folklore tales. From this point of view, no one has ever, as far as I am aware, analyzed the theme, myth, legends created by the genius of Marc Chagall. Even in the most well-founded works of Israeli art historians, an academic sterile approach prevailed, and this approach is often separates the art of the great Viteblanin from the low Yiddish culture of Central Europe. Benjamin's first pioneering article about the work of Marc Chagall appeared as planned in the catalog of the exhibition at the Guggenheim Museum. And it was a prelude to the grand contribution of Benjamin Harshav in research, history, and biography of one of the great artists of the 20th century. I do not know a better biography of Marc Chagall than a huge volume of Benjamin and Barbara Harshav, Marc Chagall and His Times, a documentary narrative. Its subtitle is with translations from Russian, Yiddish, French, German, and Hebrew by Benjamin and Barbara Harshav, Stanford University Press 2004. And it tells how this enormous job was performed by Benjamin and his soulmate Barbara. They are like their hero Marc Chagall, rooted in many cultural fields. Benjamin's own biography, his involvement, affiliation with Jewish, Russian, Western European, and American culture, his own poetic gift contributed to the depth, accuracy, credibility of his research into such a multicultural phenomenon as the art of Marc Chagall. Benevolence, honesty, and dedication were also of great importance for Benjamin's research work. In the house of Benjamin and Barbara, I was lucky enough to see unique original documents, letters and poems by Marc Chagall, written for Virginia Haggard, the companion of the artist for several years in the 1940s. Benjamin and Barbara were able to persuade the aged lady to provide them with unknown documents that shed light on their relationship. Chagall's love poems written in French with his small drawings in the margins were especially impressive. I wish to add only that admiration for the works of Chagall and understanding of the grandeur and importance of his art in world culture could not make Benjamin vanish his biography or omit information that was sometimes quite strange. And this sobriety and honesty of the biography arouses our great respect and trust in his work. Benjamin was a remarkably generous and friendly person to whom I owe every kind of help. His recommendations helped me get research grants. He organized my guest lectures at Yale University. Through him, I met interesting people, especially Professor Thomas Venslova, a known representative of Soviet dissidents and poet and scholar by himself. Without saying a word to me, Benjamin gave my book on the Russian cultural life of Vitebsk to the former editor of the Yale University Press, Jonathan Brandt. My acquaintance with Jonathan was Benjamin's invaluable gift to me, and it played a pivotal role in my life. In conclusion, I want to say that I am very grateful to my fate for my friendship with a unique person, Benjamin Harshav, and in Russian. Светлая память, дорогой Вениамин.
I would like to just add a couple comments. One is that as part of YIVO's project to digitize its what we call the Vilna collection, both here in New York and in Lithuania, we have found a new cache of letters between Marc Chagall and Max Weinreich that we did not know about. These have turned up in Lithuania. And will be digitized along with the rest of the collections. The other comment I want to make is that I was delighted to learn that the last work of Benjamin's, which I had signed up at Yale University Press, his biography of Marc Chagall, is in process, I hope with the help of Roman Utkin, who will be speaking next, it will come to fruition as well.
Hello, good evening. My name is Roman, though Benjamin called me and Bobby still calls me Roma, is we just jumped immediately to the familiar names, and I am one of those young people who've been fortunate to have been collected by Benjamin and Bobby, along with Josh and Yasha Klotz and Max Budovich, who are also in the audience today. So, and Josh, by the way, I think you're absolutely spot on about Benja, because that was the name he was called. He was Benya, he was Benjamin, Binyamin. Yes, so many, many connections and many names. So I think in my few remarks, I will complete the circle and go back to the more biographical details that were brought up by Jonathan, by Bobby, and by the wonderful documentary. And I have to say, Benjamin that I knew was already not that, I mean, he was as fascinating, but it's just a very different man that I saw on the screen, which was fascinating and also very personally valuable for me to have seen that. But, Bobby, you mentioned that Benjamin did not publish any of his memoirs, and indeed, he, it seems to me, almost resisted doing that. However, a couple of years ago, he did publish a piece in Germany, in collaboration with Benjamin. It says Benjamin Harshav in collaboration with Benjamin, which is, of course, one of his pseudonyms. And it's called Erinnerungsblasen, the bubbles of memory. And so those bubbles, very ephemeral, very transient, very precious. And but he did, excuse me, narrate his intellectual trajectory at Yale's Kerner Center for Emeritus Faculty on October 8th of 2012. And I apologize for using my laptop because I was, as people were speaking, I was trying to edit which parts to read to you. So I transcribed an hour-long monologue by Benjamin, and since for the past couple of weeks I had him in my ears, I can't help but just start imitating some of his rhythms of his speech and the way he started by saying, "You want me to talk? Okay." So I will, the little excerpts that I will read from his intellectual trajectory will touch on his childhood in Vilna, and a few words about his parents and YIVO. I thought that would be appropriate. Okay, so now I'm reading Benjamin's words, and basically, there are two trajectories here. One, a personal life in the 20th century, and one, the development of thinking about literature and literary theory. People I asked were more interested in the biographical aspect, and I think it's easier, and I shall do that. So I was born in the 20th century Europe. It doesn't matter where. The significance is basically the same. I saw Hitler, and I saw Stalin. I think those are two markers that define the field I want to talk about. The question was, to what extent do I remember really, or I imagined, and it turns out that I remember fantastic things that I couldn't remember otherwise. So I was a Jew. I always wanted to be a cosmopolitan. I always wanted to develop a theory that is valid for everything, but I couldn't help. The knowledge that I had is very much Jewish. My parents. My mother was one of 12 siblings. My father was one of three. That is significant because of my mother's 12 siblings all survived the Holocaust, all of them. Why? Because a family that has that many children had that high a pressure to get away, to get out of it. And indeed, the 12 children went to Palestina and Argentina, you name it. They were communist and Zionist, whatever. In short, my mother was an interesting person, principal of a Jewish school. There was Jewish education in four languages, Yiddish, of course, religious Hebrew, secular Hebrew, that is religious Zionist, if you want, which is a different language, and Polish for Jews. My mother was a chairman or principal of such a school, and that was a very unusual experiment at school. Fröbel, Pestalozzi, various names of educators were mentioned all the time. The founder of that school was Sofia Markovna Gurevich, almost a legendary figure, who was a daughter of a rich family of probably forest merchants, and she founded in Vilna in 1902 a gymnasium for well-bred girls, Jewish girls. She herself finished the same thing in Petersburg, but she opened it in Vilna. And that was a revolutionary thing to do, to open a school for girls and a gymnasium at that. And it was totally cosmopolitan. However, a thing happened. The Russians lost in World War I, and they had to give back to Poland the narrow area of Lithuania, Vilnius especially, and the Polish government wanted to suppress the Yiddish-speaking majority, and they demanded that all teachers speak Polish. But the teachers spoke Russian, they didn't speak Polish. And that's why they threw out Zofia Gurevich from the school. After having a gymnasium for women, she opened a gymnasium for everybody in the Yiddish language with a fanatic ideal of a secular nationhood in Yiddish somewhere in the world. When Zofia Gurevich was thrown out of her school, she went to the Soviet Union, where at that time her two brothers were high-ranking officials in Moscow. My mother. My mother was a suffragist, as it was called at the time. She was flat-chested, if you want, thin, very strong, and she had no money for the school. The school was very special because it had 50% children of intellectuals, the doctors, the philosophers, whatever, and 50% from the poverty. The school encouraged individualism, individual projects, creativity, and participation. And one story that is told is that Moshe Kulbach, who is one of the great Yiddish poets, was a teacher of literature there. And one day, he came in a bitter frost, cold, and he opened the window and said to the children, write. That's all he said. They had to write something. Of course, this helped creativity in this case. An interesting detail. Sometime when I was 7 years old, everybody had to write an essay. Children from the second to the sixth grade got such paper folded in four pages and had to write about the most interesting day in school. And that was the uniform theme. And you know what happened? My paper has survived till this day. Why? Because all the papers were stored in the school with my mother's explanation and elucidation of every child. Why doesn't he know Yiddish? Well, because he went to the Polish school and so on. And when the ghetto came, there was a book brigade directed by Crook, and his diaries I edited, Bobby translated them into English, and they were published by Yale University Press. So the book brigade had to collect books, Jewish books, from all over the city because the Nazis wanted to build an institute for the study of Judaism without the Jews. So yeah, there were specialists. Scholar Dr. Kohl was the chief of that museum. So the book brigade went from house to house collecting books to bring to the YIVO. YIVO is an institution in New York, Institute for the Research of Jewish History. But the New York thing is a copy of the Vilna institution that was five streets down from us. So the book brigade is a reconstruction. Nobody told me. The book brigade went to the school, all knew there was a school, and took all the books and all the papers and brought it to the YIVO, to YIVO in Vilna. This is a reconstruction. I cannot prove how it happened. And here you, of course, can hear Benjamin wrestling with Benjamin Harshav, the scholar. This is a reconstruction. I cannot prove how it happened. But there was Kalmanovich, a great scholar of literature and history, and he said to the book brigade, what are you doing? The book brigade, and then he's footnoting himself, the book brigade was stealing at that time and bringing the manuscripts to the ghetto and burying them in the ghetto. So Kalmanovich says, what are you doing? The Germans will do it better than you. The fact is that the Germans did better. That is, the brigade took the manuscripts, including my poor paper, to the YIVO under the Nazis. The Nazis packed it and sent it to Germany, and after World War II, people from the YIVO retrieved the YIVO material that was in the German concentration groups. And from Berlin, from Germany, it came to New York. And there was an exhibition of papers, and I said, that is my essay. That is mine. I was 7 years old. And of course, I didn't see the general picture that was a statistical inquiry about children and their papers. So it survived more than the people who wrote them. And I will stop here. Thank you.
So this concludes our remembering of Benjamin Harshav. There's one last note, which is that that Benjamin told me before his death, and Bobby has repeated this to me, that his archive will be coming to the YIVO Institute in due course, something for which we are extremely grateful. Thank you all so much for coming. Yes? Oh, the poetry. Yes, yes, yes. I'm so sorry. Yes, of course. Okay, very good.
Let me just add a footnote to that story about the notebook. When that exhibition went down, he didn't want to take it out of the exhibition, but when it was taken down, somehow that notebook got lost. And to this day, it hasn't been found, I think. And Benjamin's typical line was, "My notebook survived the Nazis, but not YIVO." So there we are. That's quite all right. No, I just wanted to make that point. He was very upset about that. I will conclude this program and really thank you all. Thanks to YIVO and Jonathan for putting it together. And thank all of you for coming out to share this evening with us. Benjamin loved language. I mean, it was, that's who he was. And poetry. And I would just like to end this thing by reading some of the poems that we translated from Hebrew and Yiddish to give you a sense, those of you who don't know, a sense of what we did. The first one, which he loved, is called The God of Israel. It's a poem by Laelis, and he was very fond of it. The God of Israel is not rich. I saw the Sistine Chapel, Notre Dame, the Cathedral of Caen. You can feast your eyes on them, you can enjoy. The God of Israel is stingy. He won't fill his museum with statues, paintings, altars, thrones, purple gowns, three-tiered crowns. He does not wish to live in a palais. The Jewish Museum has a modest display. A Hanukkah lamp, a curtain, a scroll, a spice box, tefillin, a pointing hand, a menorah, a Torah crown, tools for circumcision, and an old ancient manuscript, and another manuscript, and another manuscript, entangled, bound, locked together, letters in love with letters. What does the God of Israel ask? What does the God of Israel demand? The God of Israel is a just demander. The God of Israel is a strict demander. The God of Israel is a stingy demander. Search by yourself, research by yourself, suffer yourself for your own and for my honor. In a gray, once upon a time, from a mountaintop into a valley, he dropped two handfuls of letters, scattered them over the roads of the earth. They sparkled with speech, blazed with sayings, and since then, for thousands of years we seek them. For thousands of years we save them. For thousands of years we explain them. And there is no solution on earth for the letters, the sayings, the words. Another manuscript and another manuscript, entangled, bound, locked together, letters in love with letters. Actually, let me explain something. Benjamin and I met translating this Yiddish book. I was sort of living in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, and he had come to the Humanities Institute, and he'd gotten this offer to do a book, a translation of Yiddish poetry, and he was looking for somebody who knew English to work with him on that, and so I did. And I keep calling that that's the history of our love affair, is that book, that big red book. And it was also my first encounter with Benjamin's generosity. I just assumed that he would put me in a footnote in the acknowledgments. And to my amazement, I discovered I was being written as the co-author. So, you know, sort of like a marriage proposal, I guess. Well, the other big thing we translated was Avram Sutzkever, the great Yiddish poet. And this is a poem, let me just read a couple of the Sutzkever poems we translated. The famous one is, "Who will remain? What will remain? A wind will stay behind. The blindness will remain, the blindness of the blind. A film of foam, perhaps, a vestige of the sea. A flimsy cloud, perhaps, entangled in a tree. Who will remain? What will remain? One syllable will stay. To sprout the grass of Genesis as on a new first day. A fiddle rose, perhaps, for its own sake will stand. And seven blades of grass, perhaps, will understand. Of all the stars from way out north to here, the one star will remain that fell into a tear. A drop of wine remaining in a jar, a drop of dew. Who will remain? God will remain. Is that enough for you?" And then finally from Sutzkever, he wrote a poem that he dedicated to us, to Benjamin and me. It's called Inside Me. "Inside me, a twig of sound sways toward me as before. Inside me, rivers of blood are not a metaphor. Inside me, they gather, those who blessed me, those who rose against me, my great friends and my little enemies. Inside me, it feels so warm with them and more. Inside me, rivers of blood are not a metaphor. Inside, in sight, both life and death are truly light." Here, excuse me. No, I'm sorry. Got it all backwards. "Inside, in sight, I rolled mountains into an abyss. Still not enough. A volcano looming closer. It's lava barely breathing, stone. Inside, in sight, a blind Samson praying for strength to bring down the pillars of sun. Then he will lose his blindness. Big pupils will see on the bottom of the sea. The treasures sought in the dark, by the last dark, couldn't find in the dark. The treasures without them might life and death be unbearably light. Inside, in sight, both life and death are truly light. I must not drain it all together, I must not, even if the well may not well up forever with new riddles, even when lips kneel from above to kiss them. I must not drain the black honey, the sweet lunacy of my bones, even when lips kneel from above. Pity us, let us quench our thirst with fire. Oh, lips, lips, I love you more than all the fruits of the world, but I must not... On the bottom, I must leave the site, my lord and guardian. Two slender feet of sunset quiver in rainweb. The deep sight becomes pupils of light. Two-legged grasses, familiar faces, come to my home, my four-walled places. They kiss the mezuzah and sneak pretty fast into my bed, where I mumble, take pity. Winged woe, reveal your expertise of stinging poison into my mind, into my memories, of blowing every bitter spark in hiding. Two-legged grasses, do you bring good tiding? Two-legged grasses, solve the riddle for me. What creature would rejoice in iron comb sweeping body and soul? Who would rejoice in such a reaping? One moment, please. One more question. Shall I leave to you my legacy, my vow? The two-legged grasses piously bow. And now just a few poems from Hebrew that we did. This is from Amichai. Hanan mentioned the Dicky poems. And this is called Hulikat, the third poem about Dicky. And it's very moving, I think. I seldom can get through it without crying, so. In these hills, even the towers of oil wells are amid mere memory. Here Dicky fell, 4 years older than me, like a father to me in times of trouble and distress. Now I am older than him by 40 years, and I remember him like a young son, and I am his father, old and grieving. And you who remember only faces, do not forget the hands stretched out, the feet running lightly, the words. Remember, even the departure to terrible battles passes by gardens and windows, and children playing and a dog barking. Remind the fallen fruit of its leaves and branches. Remind the sharp thorns how soft and green they were in springtime. And do not forget, even a fist was once an open palm and fingers. This is another poem by Amichai, which written much later. This poem went to the Nobel Peace Prize ceremony. When Yitzhak Rabin won the Nobel Prize, he invited Amichai to accompany him. And there, Amichai read this poem that we translated, his poem that we translated. Hebrew writing, it's called Temporary Poem of My Time. And I should point, this was a problem of translation, a serious problem of translation, for those of you who are interested in problems of translation. It's called in Hebrew, Shir Zmani, which means either poem of my time or temporary poem. And so we compromised and call it the temporary poem of my time. Coward's way out, I guess. Hebrew writing and Arabic writing go from east to west. Latin writing from west to east. Languages are like cats. You must not stroke their hair the wrong way. The clouds come from the sea, the hot wind from the desert. The trees bend in the wind, and stones fly from all four winds into all four winds. They throw stones, throw this land one at the other, but the land always falls back to the land. They throw the land, want to get rid of it, its stones, its soil, but you can't get rid of it. They throw stones at me in 1936, 1938, 1948, 1988, Semites throw at Semites, and anti-Semites at anti-Semites. Evil men throw, and just men throw. Sinners throw, and tempters throw. Geologists throw, and theologists throw. Archaeologists throw, and arch-hooligans throw. Kidneys throw stones, and gallbladders throw. Headstones and forehead stones and the heart of a stone, stones shaped like a screaming mouth and stones fitting your eyes like a pair of glasses. The past throws stones at the future and all of them fall on the present. Weeping stones and laughing gravel stones, even God in the Bible threw stones. Even the Urim and Thummim were thrown and got stuck in the breastplate of justice. And Herod threw stones, and what came out was a temple. Oh, the poem of stone sadness. Oh, the poem of thrown on the stones. Oh, the poem of thrown stones. Is there in this land a stone that was never thrown, and never built, and never overturned, and never uncovered, never discovered, and never screamed from a wall, and never discarded by the builders, and never closed on top of a grave, and never lay under lovers, and never turned into a cornerstone? Please do not throw any more stones. You are moving the land, the holy, whole, open land. You are moving it to the sea. The sea doesn't want it. The sea says, not in me. Please throw little stones. Throw snail fossils. Throw gravel. Justice or injustice from the quarries of Migdal Tzedek. Throw soft stones. Throw sweet clods. Throw limestone. Throw clay. Throw sand of the seashore. Throw dust of the desert. Throw rust. Throw soil. Throw wind. Throw air. Throw nothing. Until your hands are weary, and the war is weary, and even peace will be weary, and will be. And the last one from Amichai. It's called The Jews. The Jews are like photos in a display window. All of them together, short and tall, alive and dead, brides and grooms, bar mitzvah boys and babies. Some are restored from old yellowed photographs. Sometimes people come and break the window and burn the pictures, and then they start photographing and developing all over again and displaying them again, sad and smiling. Rembrandt painted them wearing Turkish turbans with beautifully burnished gold. Chagall painted them hovering in the air. And I paint them like my father and my mother. The Jews are an eternal forest preserve where the trees stand dense and even the dead cannot lie down. They stand upright, leaning on the living, and you cannot tell them apart, just that fire burns the dead faster. And what about God? God lingered like the scent of a beautiful woman who once faced them in passing, and they didn't see her face. Only her fragrance remained, kinds of perfumes. Blessed be the creator of kinds of perfumes. A Jewish man remembers the sukkah in his grandfather's house, and the sukkah remembers for him. The wandering in the desert that remembers the grace of youth and the tablets of the Ten Commandments and the gold of the golden calf and the thirst and the hunger that remember Egypt. What about God? According to the settlement of divorce from the Garden of Eden and from the temple, God sees his children only once a year on Yom Kippur. The Jews are not a historical people. And not even an archaeological people. The Jews are a geological people with rifts and collapses and strata and fiery lava. Their history must be measured on a different scale. The Jews are buffed by suffering and polished by torments like pebbles on the seashore. The Jews are distinguished only in their death as pebbles among other stones. When the mighty hand flings them, they skip two times or three on the surface of the water before they drown. Some time ago, I met a beautiful woman whose grandfather performed my circumcision long before she was born. I told her, "You don't know me, and I don't know you, but we are the Jewish people, your dead grandfather, and I the circumcised, and you the beautiful granddaughter with golden hair. We are the Jewish people." And what about God? Once we sang, "There is no God like ours." Now we sing, "There is no God of ours." But we sing, we still sing. And then finally, appropriately, is the Yiddish poem by Moshe Leib Halpern called The End of the Book. That's our title, as I recall. Okay. "So I asked my dear wife how to finish the affair of my little bookie. Says she, 'Let happiness leave on a train and wave back with a hanky.' Says I, 'Hanky panky.' Says she, 'Bookie schmookie,' and asks me whether I'd like with my coffee a cookie. Says I, 'Cookie schmookie,' and tell her to put a case on my pillow and not to play hooky. Says she, 'Hooky schmookie,' and tells me to repair her shoe by hook or by crookie. Says I, 'Cookie schmookie.' So she jumps up and points at my head. I'm bald and spooky. Says I," this is where I always break down, "'Spooky, crooky, hecky, cookie, hanky, panky, booky, schmooky.' But she cannot say it as fast as I can, as fast as I can. 'Spooky, crooky, hooky, cookie, hanky, panky, booky, schmooky.' So we laugh together, laugh so nice, till she closes my eyes, and rocks me with a song of rain and light, that you sing to little children at night, children at night." Thank you again for coming. And let us all remember Benjamin with joy and laughter. Good. Thank you.